أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الصلاة والسلام على محمد وآله الطيبين الطاهرين السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته رمضان كريم And can I hear the answer please? Okay, الله أكرم Can we start with the salawat please? اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد Now, we're going to start with Quran recitation as usual And just a little bit of a reminder. When a sentence ends with ta marbuta, then we end it with a soft ha. Not ta, but a soft ha. And in the surah that we're going to recite today, which is Suratul Bayyina, the surah number 98, we'll find lots of these. And that's why I brought it up. But let's look at Suratul Bayyina and learn a little bit about it before we recite it. So, Bayyina literally means clarity or clear evidence, something that's so clear. And in this whole group of Makki surah or Makki chapters, you will find this sort of stands out. It's the Madani one in the middle. It's 98. But it's amazing because it talks about something that's clear. And just before it, we had Qadr, which talks about the book that makes clear. Now, the word bayina comes from bayina. Bayina means to separate. So it separates truth from falsehood. In essence, it is the indisputable or the message you cannot argue about of the Qur'an as taught by the Prophet. So what is the focus of this surah? The crystal clear message of the Qur'an. And this is in Ayah 5. Let's just look at what the message of the Qur'an was. The Qur'an said, وَمَا أُمِرُوا We did not tell you or did not order you to do anything illa, except, number one, لِيَعْبُدُ اللَّهِ That you will submit to Allah. You will be the slaves of Allah. You will do what he says. مُخْلِصِينَ لَحُدِّينَ You will be very sincere in your religion. Number two. Number three, hunafa. Hunafa means you'll be upright. Upright means you do the right thing. Then he says, وَيُكِيمُ الصَّلَاةَ Which we've been talking about. You will establish salah. وَيُؤْتُ الزَّكَاةَ And your salah When you establish salah in your life, you become somebody who shares. That's what zakah is all about. Sharing everything you have. وَذَٰلِكَ دِينُ الْقَيِّمَ That is the right religion. So the moment you think bayina, you think the clear message of the Qur'an. In fact, Imam Ali says, if people knew how blissful this surah is, they would leave everything to learn it. And it's surprising. I don't see many people wanting to recite this in their salah. It's only 8 ayah. We sort of divided it into 4 sections. The first section talks about the Ahlul Kitab. And it says, they divided themselves when the truth came. Because they were following practices that they didn't want to stop. They said, we'll only stop if we have a clear message or a clear proof that comes. And when the proof came, they didn't want to stop. They became divided. The second section is about the clear message of the Quran, which we talked about. And then the third section says, those who cover up the truth are the worst of creation. And then it says, the best of creation. My God, Allah talks about the reward of believing. And he talks about Jannah and the limitlessness that the human being has. So let's recite the surah together. Have you got your Qurans with you? Okay. So turn your pages to surah number, you can see it up there, it's 98. Now today I'm using a Quran that belonged to my father. And I love it, absolutely love it. I can feel him in the Quran. Make sure that your Qurans too are annotated and make sure you bugsy the Quran of your grandparents or parents because they're phenomenal Qurans. So let's recite together, okay? La ilaha illallah, la ilaha illallah. A'udhu billahi minash shaitanir rajim. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم لم يكن الذين كفروا من أهل الكتاب والمشركين منفكين حتى تأتيهم البينة رسول من الله يتلو صحفا مطهرة فيها كتب قيمة وَمَا تَفَرَّقَ الَّذِينَ أُوتُوا الْكِتَابَ إِلَّا مِنْ بَعْدِ مَا جَاءَتْهُمُ الْبَيِّنَةُ وَمَا أُمِرُوا إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُوا اللَّهَ مُخْلِصِينَ لَهُ الدِّينَ هُنَفَاءَ وَيُقِيمُوا الصَّلَاةَ وَيُؤْتُوا الزَّكَاةَ وَذَلِكَ دِينُ الْقَيِّمَةِ إِنَّ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا مِنْ أَهْلِ الْكِتَابِ وَالْمُشْرِكِينَ فِي نَارِ جَهَنَّمَ خَالِدِينَ فِيهَا أُولَئِكَ هُمْ شَرُّ الْبَرِيَّةِ إن الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات أولئك هم خير البرية جزاؤهم عند ربهم جنات عدن تجري من تحتها الأنهار خالدين فيها أبدا رضي الله عنهم ورضوا عنه ذلك لمن خشي ربه صدق الله العلي العظيم وصدق الرسول الكريم ونحن على ذلك من الشاهدين. Even if you know a surah by heart, it's always good to look at the words. It'll improve your eyesight, it'll improve the sight of your soul as well. So look at the words. It's okay if you know it by heart, but just recite it. It's beautiful. Okay, back to our du'as. We're going to start with the Aliyu Ya Azim and continue from there and look at section 19 or part 19 of Dua al-Iftita. So recite with me, okay? بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد يا علي يا عظيم يا غفور يا رحيم أنت الرب العظيم الذي ليس كمثله شيء وهو السميع البصير وهذا شهر عظمته وكرمته وشرفته وفضلته على الشهور وهو الشهر الذي فرضت صيامه عليه وهو شهر رمضان الذي أنزلت فيه القرآن هدى للناس وبينات من الهدى والفرقان وجعلت فيه ليلة القدر وجعلتها خيرا من ألف شهر فيا ذا المن ولا يمن عليك من علي بفكاك ركبتي من النار في من تمن علي وادخلني الجنة برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين اللهم أدخل على أهل القبور السرور اللهم أغني كل فقير اللهم أشبع كل جائع اللهم اكسو كل عريان اللهم اكذي دين كل مدين اللهم فرج عن كل مكروب اللهم رد كل غريب اللهم فك كل أسير اللهم أصلح كل فاسد من أمور المسلمين اللهم اشف كل مريض اللهم سد فقرنا بغناك اللهم غير سوء حالنا بحسن حالك اللهم اقضي عنا الدين واغننا من الفقر انك على كل شيء قدير اللهم رب شهر رمضان الذي انزلت فيه القران وافترضت على عبادك فيه الصيام صل على محمد وعلى محمد وارزقني حج بيتك الحرام في عام هذا وفي كل عام واغفر لي تلك الذنوب العظام فانه لا يغفرها غيرك يا رحمن يا علام اللهم salli ala Muhammadin wa ali Muhammad. Well, now to dua al-iftitah. And let's look at part 19. And here we say, Allahumma, O Allah, inna narghabu ilayk. Oh my goodness. Means, I really want, I really wish, I plead to you, I long for. You know, like something that you really want. Now, what do we want? Fi dawlatin karima, from you, I want a state, a place to live in. That means a country, somewhere where it's an honored place. You want somewhere that's honored. Now, how do we want this honor? We tell him, tu'izzu bihal Islam wa ahla, where Islam and Muslims and those people who follow Islam are honored. You say, wa tudhillu bihan nifaka wa ahla, where hypocrisy is looked down upon, where people pretend they believe something else but they do something else, is looked down upon. وَتَجْعَلُنَا فِيهَا مِنَ الدَّعَاتِ إِلَىٰ تَعَاتِكَ, and make us as those, make us of those who call people to your way. That's talking about interfaith. about us saying who we are. Remember, we talked about Surah Al Ankabut, how you start with commonalities. That's how you bring people together. وَالْقَادَةِ إِلَىٰ سَبِيلِكَ, and make us those who are forefront in your path, the leaders in your path. And then you say, وَتَرْزُقُنَا بِهَا كَرَامَةَ الدُّنْيَا وَالْآخِرَةَ, and give us the risk, the sustenance of generosity, of, how can I put this, of honor in the world and in the hereafter. So we're looking for a state where there's honor. It's a beautiful, absolute, and remember we talked about Imam Zamana, Ajallallahu Faraj, and we talked about a global government. This is what we're talking about, right? Let's go back and recite Dua al-Iftitah. Are you ready? You've got your books with you. Like I said, if you cannot read it, just listen to the words. They're beautiful. Because they're taught by Imam, they just hit your soul. Okay? So let's start. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Allahumma salli ala Muhammadin wa ali Muhammad. Allahumma inni aftatihu thana bihamdik. وأنت مسدد للصواب بمنك وإيقنت أنك أنت أرحم الراحمين في موضع العفو والرحمة وأشد المعاقبين في موضع النكال والنقمة وأعظم المتجبرين في موضع الكبرياء والعظمة اللهم أذنت لي في دعائك ومسألتك فاسمع يا سميع مدحتي وعجب يا رحيم دعوتي وأقل يا غفور وثرتي فكم يا إلهي من كربة قد فرجتها وهموم قد كشفتها وعثرة قد أكلتها ورحمة قد نشرتها وحلقتي بلاء قد فككتها الحمد لله الذي لم يتخذ صاحبة ولا ولدا ولم يكن له شريك في الملك ولم يكن له ولي من الذل وكبره تكبيرا الله أكبر الحمد لله بجميع محامده كلها على جميع نعمه كلها الحمد لله الذي لا مضاد له في ملكه ولا منازع له في أمره الحمد لله الذي لا شريك له في خلقه ولا شبيه له في عظمته الحمد لله فاشف الخلق عمره وحمده الظاهر بالكرم مجده الباسط بالجود يده الذي لا تنكس خزائنه ولا تزيده كثرة العطاء إلا جودا وكرما إنه هو العزيز الوهاب اللهم إني أسألك قليلا من كثير مع حاجة إليه عظيمة وغناك عنه قديم وهو عندي كثير وهو عليك سهل يسير اللهم إن عفوك عن ذنبي وتجاوزك عن خطيئتي وسفهك عن ظلمي وسترك على قبيح عملي وحلمك عن كثير جرمي عندما كان من خطئي وعمدي أتمعني في أن أسألك ما لا أستوجبه منك الذي رزقتني من رحمتك وأريتني من قدرتك وعرفتني من إجابتك فسرت عدوك آمنا وأسألك مستعنسا لا خائفا ولا وجلا مدلا عليك فيما قصدت فيه إليك فإن ابتعني أتبت بجهلي عليك ولعل الذي يبتعني هو خير لي لعلمك بعاقبة الأمور فلم أر مولا كريما أصبر على عبد لئيم منك علي يا ربي إنك تدعوني فأولي عنك وتتحببوا إلي فتبغضوا إليك وتتوددوا إلي فلا أقبل منك كأن لي التتول عليك فلم يمنع كذلك من الرحمة لي والإحسان إلي والتفضل علي بجودك وكرمك فَرْهَمْ مَبْدَقَ الْجَاهِلِ وَجُدْ عَلَيْهِ بِفَضْلِ إِحْسَانِكَ إِنَّكَ جَوَادٌ كَرِيمٌ الحمد لله مالك الملك مجر الفلك مسخر الرياء فالك الأسباح ديان الدين رب العالمين الحمد لله على حلمه بعد علمي والحمد لله على عفوه بعد قدرتي والحمد لله على طول أناته في غضبي وهو قادر على ما يريد الحمد لله خالق الخلق باسط الرزق فالك الأسماء ذي الجلال والإكرام والفضل والإنعام الذي بعد فلا يرى وقرب فشهد النجوى تبارك وتعالى الحمد لله الذي ليس له منازع يعادل ولا شبيه يشاقل ولا ظهير يعاضد قهر بعزته العزة وتواضع لعظمته العظمى فبلغ بقدرته ما يشاء الحمد لله الذي يجيبني حين أنادي ويستر علي كل عورة وعنا عسي ويعظم النعمة علي فلا أجازي فكم من موهبة هنية قد أعتاني وعظيمة مخوفة قد كفاني وبهجة مونقة قد أراني فأثني عليه حامدا واذكره مسبها الحمد لله الذي لا يهتك حجابه ولا يغلق بابه ولا يرد سائل ولا يخيب عامل الحمد لله الذي يؤمن الخائفين وينجي الصالحين ويرفع المستضعفين ويضع المستكبرين ويهلك ملوكا ويستخلف آخرين والحمد لله قاسم الجبارين مبير الظالمين مدرك الحاربين نكال الظالمين صريخ المستصرخين موضي حاجات الطالبين معتمد المؤمنين الحمد لله الذي من خشيته ترعد السماء وسكانها وترجف الأرض وأمارها وتموج البحار ومن يسبح في غمراتها الحمد لله الذي هدانا لهذا وما كنا لنهتدي لولا أن هدانا الله الحمد لله الذي يخلق ولم يخلق ويرزق ولا يرزق ويطعم ولا يطعم ويميت الأحياء ويحيي الموتى وهو حي لا يموت بيده الخير وهو على كل شيء قدير اللهم صل على محمد عبدك ورسولك وعمينك وسفيك وحبيبك وخيرتك من خلقك وحافظ سرك ومبلغ رسالاتك أفضل وأحسن وأجمل وأكمل وأزكى وأنمى وأطيب وأطهر وأسنى وأكثر ما صليت وباركت وترحمت وتحننت وسلمت على أحد من عباد وأنبيائك ورسلك وصفتك وأهل الكرامة عليك من خلقك اللهم وصل على علي أمير المؤمنين ووصي رسول رب العالمين عبدك ووليك وأخي رسولك وحجتك على خلقك وآيتك الكبرى والنبأ العظيم وصل على الصديقة الطاهرة فاطمة الزهراء سيدة النساء العالمين وصل على سبتي الرحمة وإمامي الهدى الحسن والحسين سيدي شباب أهل الجنة وصل على أئمة المسلمين علي بن الحسين ومحمد بن علي وجعفر بن محمد وموسى بن جعفر وعلي بن موسى ومحمد بن علي وعلي بن محمد والحسن بن علي والخلف الحادي المهدي حججك على عبادك ومنائك في بلادك صلاة كثيرة دائمة اللهم وصل على ولي أمرك القائم المعمل والعدل المنتظر وهفه بملائكتك المكرمين وأيده بروح القدس يا رب العالمين اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد اللهم اجعله داعي إلى كتابك والقائم بدينك استخلفه في الأرض كما استخلفت الذين من قبلي مكن له دينه الذي ارتضيته لا عبدله من بعد خوفي أمنا يعبدك لا يشرك بك شيئا اللهم عزه وعزز بي وانصره وانتصر بي وانصره نصرا عزيزا وافتح له فتحا يسيرا واجعل له من لدنك سلطانا نسيرا اللهم اظهر به دينك وسنة نبيك حتى لا يستخفي بشيء من الحق مخافة أحد من الخلق اللهم إنا نرغب إليك في دولة كريمة تعز بها الإسلام وأحلى وتذل بها النفاق وأحلى وتجعلنا فيها من الدعاة إلى طاعتك والقادة إلى سبيلك وترزقنا بها كرامة الدنيا والآخرة اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد. Can we have a salawat please? اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد. Right, let's come to the month of Ramadan. So first of all, Maryam made the whole scene of Masjid al-Kufa from Lego. Maryam calls me Mosque Nani, and I absolutely adore the young lady. Ali Rida made a sadaqah box to help others in the name of Imam Ali. Fatima recited her first majlis at home after iftar on Imam Ali, and I thought, oh my goodness, her dad made some boxes for her like a mimbar, and she sat up there and she recited majlis. My goodness, I look forward to listening to these majlis in the years to come. Hassan from Qum made a Ramadan corner. So he listens in from Qum. He made a Ramadan corner, a banner for Imam Ali. It's amazing. As well as a sadaqah box. He's got a good deed jar and he made binoculars for sighting the moon soon. And I'd like you to pray for Ghaniza's dad. He's really very, very ill. His name is Sayyid Muhammad Qasim Qadhimi. Please pray for him. So if you can close your eyes for a minute and say a little dua. Allahumma shfi kulla mareed. It is Allah who gives shifa to all those who are ill. But pray for him. Maybe we'll recite Surah Al-Fatiha, remember him. So I thought I would do the A to Z of Salah today. And remember, we did A for Adhan, B for Book, C for Connect, D for Dua, E for Essentials, the Rukn, F for Forgiveness, G for Gratitude, H for Home, I for Intention, J for Jahar or Jama'a, K for, do you remember? Qaaba, L for Layl, M for Masjid, Noon for, or N for Noor, O for One, and Obedience to the One. And today we were going to do P for Peace, and I was going to look at the Taslim, or the Salam that we recite at the end, but I just couldn't, because all I could think of was Imam Ali. When I thought about the Kaaba, I thought, well, Qibla, I thought, Imam Ali is born in the Kaaba. I thought about Sajda, and I thought about Imam Ali in his Sajda. And you can see on the screen a picture of Masjid al-Kufa. This is where he was struck on the head. I just couldn't do the A to Z. I looked at Ruku, and I thought about him giving the ring away in Ruku. That is Surah number 5, Ayah 55. I thought of Salam, you know, and I was going to talk about P for Peace and Salam. But I remember the peace at his haram in Najaf. Let us pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant us the tawfiq for all of us to be able to go. You actually feel that you're at home. So I thought, I'm not going to talk about this today. I just couldn't. There's no way I can talk about it. So I'm just going to talk about Imam Ali. And I'd like you to hear, because it comes from the heart. You know, when you say Ali, your heart just fills up. And it should. It really should. He was the most phenomenal human being. The most perfect student of the Prophet. He defended him. He supported him. The Prophet used to say, Ya Ali, ma arafaka illa Allah wa ana. Nobody understands you except Allah and me. He was the bravest. His humility. I mean, you know, when we recited the Munajat of Imam Ali, can you imagine in the middle of the night, this bravest person would get up and he would cry and he would speak to Allah like this. He was known as the father of the orphans. And you know, so much about him. That is just phenomenal. All I can say is that you just fall in love with this character. You just look at him and you can think, you don't know what to talk about. It's like looking at a star-filled sky. Which star do I pick? But I know that the only way to love someone is to know them. And the only way you know someone is through their words. The Prophet said, every human being lies under his tongue. In other words, in his words. Now, my father died when I was 10 years old. He was very young. He was barely 35. But there were three books that he kept all the time. One was the Quran, one was Mafatihul Jinan, and one was Nahjul Balagha. I was intrigued by Nahjul Balagha. It was a brown book, and it was embossed with his initials, and it had a translation in Urdu. I used to leaf through the pages as a child after he died, praying that one day I would be able to read this book. And one bookmark in this book was etched in my mind because there was a neatly folded corner with my birth date on it. And this was letter number 31. Now, the little Urdu I knew told me that this was a letter written by Imam Ali to Imam Hassan on his way back from Siffin when he camped at a place called Al-Hadarin. So I remember as a child, I made a mental note that one day I would make this my life plan. Days became months and months became years. When my first child was born, I looked at her for the first time, and inside me there was this feeling which said what my father always used to say to me, and it's in this letter where Imam says, وَجَدْتُكَ بَعْضِي بَلْ وَجَدْتُكَ كُلِّي حَتَّى كَأَنَّ شَيْئًا لَوْ أَصَابَكَ أَصَابَنِي وَكَانَ الْمَوْتَ لَوْ أَتَاكَ أَتَانِي. I find you a part of myself. My father used to tell me this. Rather, I find you as my whole, so much so that if anything happens to you, it's as though it's happening to me. If death comes to you, it's as though it comes to me. And I remember at that time, I went out and bought a copy of Nahjul Balagha. And since then, I've tried to fall in love with Imam Ali through his words. So to inspire you to do the same, I'm going to share some tiny little drops from this massive ocean, which is known as Imam Ali, with you. But it's Nahjul Balagha. So I'm going to talk a little bit about it. So Nahjul Balagha was compiled first by a scholar known as Sayyid Radhi. Sayyid Radhi lived for 45 years. His father was a descendant of Imam Musa Qadim, and his mom was a descendant of Imam Sajjad. He used to work 18 hours a day to try and put all this together. He had a phenomenal brother, Sayyid Murtaza. So Sayyid Murtaza and Sayyid Radhi, there's lots of stories about them. Look them up. They were amazing people. Their teacher was called Sheikh Mufid. In fact, when he died, his brother and teacher were so sad, they couldn't even lead his Salah al-Mayyad. It had to be the Prime Minister of that time who led it. He was phenomenal. So I'm going to start off by telling you little bits from this book. And I just don't know where to start. Anyway, let me take little bits. In this book, Imam says, "Man arafa nafsahu faqad arafa rabbahu." If you have recognized yourself, then you have recognized God. So the book teaches me that the greatest achievement of the human being is not in its works of art or science or technology, but in the recognition of himself, to know ourselves. Imam says, when he talks about people who are going through difficult times, he said, look how you live. See what you're doing. See the suffering you're creating. And the teaching is very simple, something that we can put together in our nights of Qadr. One that you might hear all the time, he said, be like the flower that leaves its fragrance even on the hand that crushes it. Think about it. Be like the flower that leaves its fragrance even on the hand that crushes it. He said, sometimes silence is the most eloquent answer, which means sometimes just being quiet is the best of answers. And Nahjul Balagha encourages us to look deeper into life. You know, Imam warns us that don't identify with I have, therefore I am. And the more I have, the more I am. You know, Descartes said, I think, therefore I am. Imam said, I am when I let go of any self-definitions and when I surrender to divinity, which means I am nothing but that which submits to Allah. So now let's look at letter 31, which I told you I try to base my life upon. And I'll go through some of the things Imam wrote. He said, the first thing he tells his son is, Usika bitaqwa Allah. Hold on to God consciousness. What does that mean? That means know that you're protecting yourself and you're watched all the time. You're conscious of the fact that there is Allah everywhere. He told him, no connection is more reliable than the one between you and Allah. He told his son, study the lives of past people. Ponder, think over their activities, where they were and where they are now. Give up discussing what you don't know. What doesn't concern you, just give up discussing it. He told him, watafaqahu fi ddeen. Think, study religion. Make yourself the measure of dealing between you and others. That means when you do something for somebody else, when you do something wrong, not right, think, will I like it? Would I have liked this sort of behavior? Don't say to others what you would not like to be said to you. It's simple stuff, but it's really important. He told him, know that he who owns the treasures of the heavens and the earth has permitted you to pray to him and has promised acceptance. He has not placed anything between you and him. And if you make a mistake, he hasn't prevented you from doing tawbah, nor does he increase or hasten or hurry your punishment. فَإِذَا نَادَيْتَهُ سَمِعَ النِّدَاءَ وَإِذَا نَاجَيْتَهُ عَلِمَ النَّجْوَاكَ. He said, when you call him, he hears you. And when you have a secret inside you, he knows your secrets. So place before him your needs. Unveil yourself before him. Complain to him of your worries. Seek help in your affairs. Talk to Allah. Sit on your musalla. Don't just make it a ritual. In your kunut, talk to him. Tell him all these things. This is what Imam says. He says, he's shown you the way to ask him. He says, place your religion and your world at his disposal. That means give it to Allah. Tell him, give me the best of this in the world and in the next. He said quite a lot of things in this letter. And maybe you can read a little bit more. I'd like to look a little bit more at his will as well. We talked about it yesterday. Let me add a little bit more. And then we will go to Masaib. And then we will look at Surah Ar-Rum, which we're going to do as our Quran study today. So, in from his will, he said, I advise you and all my children, my relatives, and whoever receives this message, that's you and me. He said, be conscious of Allah. Always be conscious, God conscious. Remove your differences. Don't fight with each other. Don't argue with each other. Strengthen your ties. Make your bonds stronger. He said, I heard your grandfather say, that is the prophet say, reconciliation of your differences is more worthy than all your prayers and all your fasting. Can you imagine? Leave all your mustahab fasting and praying aside. Keep the wajib. Put all the mustahab aside. But make sure that you are at peace with everyone. That's what Imam is saying in his will. And when somebody says something in their will, that's really, really important. He said, remain attached to the Quran. Nobody should surpass you in being intent on it or more sincere in implementing it. That means it's like a competition. You got to be more attached to the Quran than anybody else. This is what Imam said. He said, be in awe of Allah in relation to your salah. It's the pillar of religion. So what did he say? Make sure that you're at peace with everyone. Attach yourself to the Quran so much so that when people see you, they say, ah, this is the Quran person. And your salah, they say this is a salah person. Maintain communication and exchange opinions amongst yourselves. In other words, listen to other people. Be tolerant of them. Don't just say my way or the highway. Beware of disunity and enmity. And then he told them, persist in striving in the cause of Allah. We've been talking about jihad a lot. Trying really hard in belief and amal as-salihat. And he says, with your money, with your souls, with your tongue, don't yearn for the world. Don't crave for the world. Don't be seduced by it. That means don't be taken in by it. Don't resent on anything you have missed in it. Because their greater things are those that lie with Allah. What you do for others, how you serve humanity, how you become a person that is useful to somebody else is far more important. But let's look at what happened on the 19th of Ramadan. I mentioned a little bit yesterday. We talked about how Imam was struck on his head in sajda by Ibn Muljim. But let me tell you about who Ibn Muljim was. Ibn Muljim was a slave whom Imam Ali actually paid to be free. He made him free. He gave him a little bit of money. He gave him as much as he could to help him build his life. Yet it was this man who struck Imam Ali on his head. Now, I was listening to much less by a scholar who said this, and it really made me think. So you can imagine Imam is now brought to his home. In fact, when he got near his home, he told everyone to leave. And he said, please leave, because when my children see me, or my daughters see me, they're going to cry. I don't want you to hear them. So they took Imam inside. But it is said that somebody came to be able to visit Imam Ali. He found out, and you know, people all go to visit when they know somebody's hurt or somebody's ill. And he said, I came to the house of Ali and I saw a long queue of children standing outside. And each child was holding a cup of milk. And he said, I asked them, what are you doing here? And all of them said that the doctors have said that milk is good to make you better, to strengthen you. So we've brought this milk. We're orphans. We've brought this milk for the person who was like our dad. We want our dad back. We want him to get better. So we've brought him some milk. Imam was surrounded by his family. So you can imagine today is the 19th of Ramadan. Today and tomorrow, he's surrounded by his family. And he speaks a few words to each of them because he asks everybody to leave except his family. We're told that Imam Hassan was sitting near his head and Imam Hussein was sitting near his feet. And Imam Hussein was crying, he was sobbing. And he said, Bunayya. Bunayya is like a really awesome way to say my son. He said, Bunayya, don't cry, don't cry. Your day will be harder than mine. La yawmaka yawmik. There's no day like yours. Then he took all his children, he took all their hands and he gave them to Imam Hassan. He said, you will look after them. He called Sayyidah Zainab and he said, you will walk in these streets as a prisoner. She couldn't comprehend it. I have a brother, like Abba, she must be thinking. Me walking in the streets like a prisoner? In one corner, Umul Baneen was crying. And he said, why are you crying? And she said, you called everyone, but you didn't call my Abbas. So Imam Ali calls Abbas and he kisses his hands. And Umul Baneen says, you hugged everyone and you kissed their necks. You're kissing my Abbas's hands. And he says, these hands one day are going to speak. They're going to help my Hussein. And he gave Hazrat Abbas's hands to Imam Hussein. Then he turned to his sons Hassanain. That's Imam Hassan and Imam Hussein. And he said, I see Rasulullah and I see Sayyidah Fatima. He says to both of them, he said, you will give me ghusl. The hunut that I use for Rasulullah, you will use. You know what hunut is? Hunut is where you put sand on the seven parts of your body which touch sajda, right? And we use a little bit of the earth, we put a little bit of camphor, and we use a little bit of earth that comes from Karbala. Okay, so he said, you will put this on my, this is what I use for Rasulullah, you will use the same one for my hunut. And he said, you will recite seven takbirs in my Salatul Mayyit. The other person from whom there will be seven is the Mahdi, ajalallahu farajah. Can you see the connection? He tells his son, carry my janazah from behind. The front will go itself. There'll be angels will be carried it. Think about this. Think about this most awesome man. You know, today is the day, today, tomorrow, that we think about him. If you have time, then you will recite the Munajat of Imam Ali again today, as many times as possible, right? It's just, you have to connect to Ali. There is none like Ali, none, believe me, most perfect student of Rasulullah. Okay, can I have a salawat, please? Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad wa ajjal faraja. So what I'd like to do now is look at Surah Ar-Rum. We've looked at Surah Al Ankabut, and I'd like to look at Surah Ar-Rum. It has 60 ayat. It's a Makki surah. And the reason why I want to look at it is because Imam Sadiq says, whoever recites both Surah Al Ankabut and Surah Ar-Rum on the 23rd night of Ramadan will definitely, mark my words, he says, definitely be amongst the residents of Jannah without any exception. And he said, وَلَا أَقُولُ inshallah. I don't even say inshallah. And then he added, I don't fear that Allah will record a sin against me for giving such a status for these two chapters. So we've got to learn them. Now we've done Ankabut in detail. I'd like you to listen and at least think about Surah Ar-Rum and start reciting it as well. So first of all, let's look at the focus. So if somebody said, what is Surah Ar-Rum about? Well, the first thing you're going to think about is superpowers. At that time, the superpowers were the Sassanids, or rather you had the Persians and you had the Romans. Okay, the Byzantines and the Sassanids. So these are the superpowers at that time. We'll talk about it in a minute. There is an abundance of reflection on the signs of Allah. I mean, so many. We'll talk about them as much as we can. And then it says there's no excuse accepted on the day of Qiyamah. That's it. No excuses at all. You can't say but. There are no buts. You just have to look around you. Then it tells us to have sabr. Sabr is trying hard and then waiting, handing it over to him. Once we've tried 110%. And then it says, don't ever underestimate the strength of iman. Never, never think it is something that small. So let's look at the surah. Oh, there's a little did you know. I always put a did you know in surahs. The human being, all of us, we're pre-programmed in our fitrat. You know, inside ourselves, we have an operating system, which is pre-programmed with good things, with Allah's human values, gratitude, humility, mercy, love, justice, humanity, all that. It's pre-programmed in us. Revelation, which means the Quran and the Masumeen, activate it. They make it come alive. They make us want to be good people, people with good human values, and it makes it practical and we incline towards the truth. Otherwise, it stays sort of asleep inside. That's why Laylatul Qadr and Surah Ar-Rum, because Laylatul Qadr activates that goodness inside us, and we've got to take it into account. So the ayah is ayah 30, quite easy to remember. Surah number 30, ayah 30, and it says, فَأَكِمْ وَجْهَكَ لِلدِّينِ حَنِيفًا. Stand up, set your face upright for the right religion. فِطْرَةَ اللَّهِ الَّتِي فَطَرَ النَّاسَ عَلَيْهَا. The nature which Allah made, His nature, Allah's nature, He made into human beings. So He programmed us with this operating system which He designed, which was goodness, just goodness. لَا تَبْدِيلَ لِخَلْكِ اللَّهِ. You cannot change Allah's creation. ذَلِكَ الدِّينُ الْقَيِّمُ. That is the right religion. وَلَكِنَّ أَكْثَرَ النَّاسِ لَا يَعْلَمُونَ. But most people don't know. So let's look at the sections of Surah Ar-Rum. So the first section is Ayah 1 to 7. And there's a prediction of victory. Gulibatul Rum, it says. You see, what happened was at that time, there was a seesaw between the two superpowers, the Romans and the Persians. Sometimes the Romans won, sometimes the Persian ones. And here, at the time the surah was revealed, the Persians were in charge. So they were right at top, and it was all about this little bit of land. When I say little bit, lots of land, Turkey, Palestine, Syria, and they were fighting for it. And this surah says, the Romans are going to win. Bidh isinin means up to 9 years. And exactly 9 years later, the Romans won. And it also said that the mu'mineen are going to be really happy. Well, they were happy because at the same time, to the victory of the Battle of Badr. Remember we talked about it? So that's the first thing. It predicted it. The second section looks at reflection in human society. It tells me, think about life and death. You're created from dust. Think about the different languages people speak, the different colors of human beings. When you sleep at night, you work in the day, lightning, rain, life to the dead earth. Think about the heavens and the earth. Allah is saying, just reflect. Remember the Prophet said, 1 hour's reflection is better than 70 years of worship. 1 hour. So just sit down and think, who made all this? How does this work? The third section is reflection on human beings and our relationship with our Creator. So this is where Allah says, I've pre-programmed you. In times of trouble, you turn to Allah. But when I show you mercy, you turn back. He says, everything you have is from me. And then He tells you what to do with it. Share with your family, with the needy, with refugees. Give out. Don't go for interest. Don't charge more than is owed. That's exploitation. That means you're using somebody else's skills and abilities for your benefit. Be mindful of the day of judgment. In section 4, he says, now look at the signs of nature. Look at the wind. Look at the rain. Look at your traveling. And he talks about ships, but I'll talk about airships as well. He just said ships, those who sail on the sea, but it also talk about airships that goes in the air. How do they sustain themselves? He said, look at rain, look at life on earth. And then he says in this section, if after all these signs, you're still deaf and blind, and you don't understand belief in Allah, then you can never be guided. And then finally, at the end of this section, he says, look at the circle of life. You started off as a baby. You were so weak. You couldn't even talk or walk or feed yourself or nothing. You were so weak. And then you became the strong thing. And you had so much strength. But then suddenly you go back to weakness when you get really old. He said, think, reflect. In section 5, it's a bit scary. Day of Qiyamah is bound to happen. There are no excuses that are accepted. And in this Quran, there is every single example. And finally, in the last section, Allah says, patience. That means try hard. Patience is not just waiting. Sabr is perseverance and waiting. And then he says, don't underestimate the strength of belief. Now, I'm going to put it in a nutshell so you can listen to it in a few lines, okay? So the surah begins with a prediction of the victory of the Romans over the Persians 9 years before the event. So it also then takes you to the victory at Badr. And then this takes us to the central theme of the surah. So if anybody asks you, what is Surah Al-Rum about? It's actually about the abundance of signs of Allah wherever you look, in ourselves, in society, in nature. And basically what Allah is trying to say, that the rise and fall of nations is nothing compared to the signs of Allah all around you. And then he says, the inability of the human being not to recognize Allah even when he sees these signs is because he follows his own whims. His own whims means his own thinking. Then Allah says, all human beings are pre-programmed with fitrah. All of us have good human values. And that basically is the cornerstone of the Quran, that we are all programmed for goodness. And then there's a challenge to those who cover up the truth. And Allah says, substantiate your claims. That means tell me how you came to this conclusion. And then the inevitability of accountability, which means the day of Qiyamah is going to happen. I will have to account for everything I've done, and no signs, nothing, no excuses will be acceptable. So inshallah, you will read Surah Al-Rum leading up to the 23rd of Ramadan. We will need to read Rum and Ankabut, and inshallah, tomorrow, if we have time, we will look at, not tomorrow, day after, we will look at Surah Al-Dukhan, which is Surah number 44. These are the three chapters, the three surah of the Quran that we recite. So, inshallah, I will see you tomorrow, but today let us end with reciting Surah Al-Fatiha. We will recite the dua for protection, and we will recite the ziyara of Imam Hussein. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين. صدق الله العظيم. Close your eyes, look down, ask Allah to give the thawabs to all the marhumin, especially those of your family. Pray for those who are ill, and I asked you to pray for Kaniz's dad, who's really ill. Pray for those who are in trouble. There's lots of people who are going through very, very difficult times. Please pray for them. We'll now recite the dua for protection. لي خمسة أطفي بها حر الوباء الحاتمة المصطفى والمرتضى وأبناهما والفاطمة لي خمسة أطفي بها حر الوباء الحاتمة المصطفى والمرتضى وأبناهما والفاطمة السلام عليك يا أبا عبد الله وعلى الأرواح التي حلت بفنائك عليك مني سلام الله أبدا ما بقيت وبقي الليل والنهار ولا جعله الله آخر العهد مني لزيارتكم السلام على الحسين وعلى علي بن الحسين وعلى أولاد الحسين وعلى أصحاب الحسين اللهم صل على محمد وعلى محمد Let us pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give us the tawfiq to be able to be Ahl al-Quran, to be those who are the lovers of Imam Ali, and give us a tawfiq to learn about this amazing personality. We really need to know a little bit more about him. And finally, I will see you tomorrow, inshallah. At the same time, we will be doing amals tomorrow for the 21st night of Ramadan. So make sure that your books, your Quran, everything is ready so we can do these amals. And try and read through to Room if you can, and the Munajat of Imam Ali. في أمان الله كريم ربنا تقبل منا إنك أنت السميع العليم